So we'll finish our lecture with a bit about power planning. Let's remember something about power consumption and reliability. So in general, we have dynamic power, we have static power or leakage, and we have the floor plan and the design of the grid. All of this goes into our power consumption and reliability planning. So we have the first problem of average or instantaneous power. So we usually call that IR drop, for I being conductance and R being resistance, or I being current and R being resistance. So IR is a voltage drop, or we have a voltage droop where we actually have these small drops. So IR drop is usually this average power drop. And what we see here is that if the voltage, instead of being this constant VDD that we always assume, it starts to jump around, we can have a point where our cells will fail working correctly. And we have the other thing is a power density problem in the long run, where after using our sending a lot of current through a certain inductor, it can break or short or whatever, and that's called electromigration, or that's usually what we call it. There are different names and different phenomena. So IR drop, as I said, is the drop in the supply voltage over the length of the line. So if we have here some sort of a resistor, an inverter driving some sort of other inverter, and we have some sort of VDD, a power and a ground over here, if we have resistance on the line and we have some current going into here, we get some sort of a voltage drop. And the voltage drop means that our inverter gets VDD minus delta V. In the same way, we have a return path for the current that goes through the resistor, and we have another delta V over here. So what we get is delta V at the bottom of this. We get delta V over here, excuse me. And that means that we'll get some sort of a delta V on the output as well, which will be the input again to our next stage and so forth. So this is a very bad thing to have IR drop. How do we analyze this? Well, what we'll usually do is we'll draw up our whole layout of our power grid, of how the power actually gets to each and every gate, and we make some sort of a matrix of the resistances or conductances and the current sources, which are the gates themselves, and then we can solve the matrix and find out for every point on the design what the IR drop is, either in an average case, which we usually call again average IR drop, or on a dynamic basis when there is actually some sort of a vector that changes inside the design, and we see that there are these dynamic things that can happen, especially in a digital design. After you have a rising edge of the clock, everything starts toggling, and that can cause these instantaneous voltage droops to be really bad. Electromigration, which is the other issue of the long-term kind of reliability, it refers to the gradual displacement of the metal atoms of a conductor as a result of a current flowing through that conductor. It's transfer of electron momentum. So the current goes through the conductors and the little electrons hit the atoms that are here, and eventually we can have things break, like over here, or just change their size. We can have hillux also be created that can actually cut through the dielectric and short two different wires. So there are a lot of things that can happen reliability-wise due to a lot of current running through a small inductor, conductor. So this results either in opens, which are a void on a single wire, or shorts, which is bridging between two wires. And even without an open or a short, electromigration can cause performance degradation. So if our conductor here gets thinner, then we have a higher resistance in such a thing. Therefore, we have to solve this by distributing the power in our whole chip. So power distribution has several functions. First of all, it has to carry the current from the pads, the external, the IOs, the pads of the transistor, to the of the chip to the transistors. It's supposed to maintain a stable voltage with low noise. So we want to have VDD, we want to have ground, we don't want to have all kinds of other types of values there, or else all of our static timing analysis will be wrong and our analog blocks won't operate like we simulated. We want to be able to provide average and peak power demands. We want to provide return paths for the signal current, and we have to avoid electromigration and self-heating wear out. So how do we achieve that? We make wider power lines, right? Wider power lines means that we get smaller R, and then the total IR is smaller, so we get less static IR drop, or average current. We get less dynamic, what's called DI to DT drop, so that's because of the large inductances that we often have in the connections from the package to the chip when we start changing the current suddenly because of like a rising clock edge or something. Then we can get this type of a DI to DT drop that also reduces our voltage. And we get less electromigration because we have wider wires. There is a lower probability that an atom will be displaced by being hit by an electron. However, we also want to consume little chip area and wire, and we want to make it easy to lay out so we can deal with it. So these kind of contradict each other. We want to have our cake and eat it too. If we make our power lines wider, we're going to have fewer signals for routing, fewer wires for routing, and we're going to have higher congestion. So what's the challenge of power distribution? Well, let's assume we have a 1 millimeter long power rail in metal one, and that does make sense since, say, we have a chip and there's some area of the core that's 1 millimeter wide. Well, we have these VDD and these ground rails that will be 1 millimeter long, routed in metal one in a pretty small metal one. Okay, we're given a square resistance. R square equals a typical value of 0.1 ohm to square. Right, so that's our R square. If we make a 100 nanometer wide rail, and let's say we're in like a 28 or a 40 nanometer process, that's a pretty wide, even I would say, wire. So it's not a minimum sized wire. What's the resistance of the wire? So once we're given our R square value over here, we can figure out what the resistance is, and it's just R equals R square times the number of squares, which is the length of the wire over the width of the wire, and that comes out to be 1,000 ohms. 1 kilo ohm is the resistance of that wire from side to side. Well, that sounds like a lot. It's for sure not zero. So let's say we have a max current of 1 milliamp per micron. So that's that's what the electromigration guidelines will tell us. Don't have a current over 1 milliamp per micron. So let's say we design our power grid to be at max electromigration, and we have 1 milliamp per micron. What's the IR drop when we conduct this wire, this current through the wire? So the maximum current is 1 milliamp per micron times 100 nanometers. That gives us 0.1 milliamps. So the IR drop is this max current times the resistance of the wire, and that gives us 100 millivolts, which is pretty bad. So what are we supposed to do? Well, we can make the power rails as wide and as thick as possible, and then we get a lot fewer squares, or we get a lot lower resistance. So let's say what we do to analyze the IR drop. We make a hot, like a temperature map of the IR drop around the chip. So this highlights hot spots where the IR drop is bad. And here's an example given by Cadence at one of their CDN Lives, where we see this chip that has this area that you can tell there's something wrong here. There's this big hot spot. The IR analysis tool, IR drop analysis tool, tells us that, listen, there's something wrong here. We're getting like really good IR drop all around, and then this area just gets this really bad red area. Well, what do we see? They just added one stripe of metal, and look how much better it got. So that is what IR drop analysis allows us to do and helps us fix these potentially failure-prone problems. So how do we do this? We need to route power and ground. Every standard cell has power and ground signals. So this is usually a VDD, and this is usually ground, right? VDD and ground. And what we do is we have these rails that are VDD, ground, VDD, right? And that way we can just stick these boxes inside, and we get both VDD and ground inside our standard cell. And that's how we solve this solution of how do we provide VDD and ground to each CMOS gate, which needs both of these power rails. However, we can have that large resistance, as we saw before, going through these long wires. So what we want to do is we want to make the resistance from wherever the power pad is until it reaches each and every gate to be much smaller. And that we usually do with what we call a power mesh. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll often take the power pads that that provide VDD from the package. They'll be connected to rings, VDD and let's say ground, something like that. From the package, they'll connect to, say, a ring that distributes it well. There may be several, or there probably will be several of these VDD ground pairs from outside. So we would say we have sort of an equipotential around the chip. Then we'll add these stripes that they connect to these rings, and they can provide the power in a much better way. Usually these are hierarchical, so we'll start from the top. We'll use the top very wide and high wires that have a very low R square, and we'll use them predominantly to connect to VDD and ground. And then as we go down lower, where we need to actually connect to the metal one here that connects then to the transistors themselves, we'll just use some via stacks and some smaller stripes. We'll use a lot of vias between the layers to minimize the via resistance, which can get big. You can imagine that these are huge networks. In general, to make it happen easily, we make these power ground routings very regular, so we can do it with some sort of automatic scripting, and we don't have to really deal with every single wire. We just use some sort of script that puts every certain pitch, it puts another wire and it makes another via stack and so forth. So we usually reserve these routing for power ground routing, and we do it early on in the floor plan, and then we can't use this for our signal routing or clock routing afterwards. So how do we do this? The standard approach, as I mentioned before, is what we call a power grid. We interconnect with these horizontal and vertical wires, VDD and ground. Often well over half of the total metal on the upper thicker layers is used for VDD and ground. That's almost the only way that power and ground routing is done nowadays. However, there is another type of an approach, which is called dedicated VDD and ground planes, that the DEC Alpha 21264 used. And there you take a whole sheet of metal in a certain plane and use it just for VDD, and another one just for ground. It also causes a lot of good capacitance between VDD and ground, which we want, which we'll see in a moment. But it's really expensive in terms of routing resources and hardly ever done. As far as I know, AMD did it on some of their processors as well. It makes the whole matrix analysis a lot easier though too. So what we should do is we should also co-optimize the power and ground IOs. We should use decoupling capacitors. So what we want to do is, if we have a VDD over here and ground over here, in order to make them less noisy, we want a lot of capacitance between them. Remember, these are DC voltages. They're not supposed to change. To make them change less, we want to put big capacitors to clear out all of those little frequencies. Or in other words, we want to add a lot of charge in between here. So if all of a sudden there's an inverter over here that needs to make a switch, it can take its charge from these local capacitances rather than having to draw them from the main battery. Okay, so that's why we want a lot of cap, as much cap as possible as we can between VDD and ground, and that will add decoupling capacitors wherever we can. We'll just add these extra caps, and the caps can be in a standard cell that just has like a MOS cap or some sort of other cap in it, and it can also just be by putting a VDD and a ground wire next to each other, and the coupling capacitance is actually good for us. Okay, when we want to go over to multiple voltage and frequency islands, as we discussed before, the power ground problem on clock distributions become much, much more challenging. So how do we create power grids? We're going to trade off IR drop and electromigration versus the routing resources. Remember, the more power we put, the better our IR drop problem and our electromigration problem will get, but we'll have less resources for routing our signals themselves. So we need to make some sort of estimation, then figure out what the average current is and what the max current density in everywhere is before we decide how much metal we're going to actually give to the power grid from the beginning. Then we need to build this top-down type of a hierarchical approach. We're going to say every single metal, how much of it is going to be power and ground, how many vias are going to connect between the different levels, and so forth. Do we need to have all kinds of things like power gating and multiple voltages? How many power pads actually do we have to have for each voltage? And that depends on how many simultaneously switched IOs we're going to have, which letters layers are going to be used, what the width and spacing between them are, what the via stacks are, if we're going to have rings around our chip, and et cetera, if we're going to have some shielding as well. So as you can see here, if this was our whole routing resource, if we use all of this and all of this for power, then that's all we have left for routing. There's going to be a lot on the lower layers and very little room for routing signals on the top layers. We should run an initial power network analysis or an early rail analysis to confirm that what we're doing is right. So just as a kind of a summary about that, blocks with the highest performance and highest power consumption, what we're going to do with them is we'll try to move them close to the edges so their IR drop becomes the lowest, and we're going to move them away from each other. On modern designs, actually, this is all kind of alleviated because we use this approach called flip chip, where we actually put these connections to the package in the middle, and then we can have direct connection from VDD and from ground to the metal layers that are right in smack in the middle of the chip. And that's the main usage of this flip chip type design, which is much more expensive than a traditional wire bonded design. So as a summary, let's see how we floor plan in our place and route tool. So floor planning is very specific to each design and can include many commands. And you're going to have to always change this according to your specific design. But the general flow or parts of the design is we're going to first initialize our design, which means we're going to have to define all our inputs, our Verilog netlist, our MMMC, which includes the timing, SDC extraction, etc., what our LEF abstracts are, where our IOs are placed. Then we're going to move over to the specify floor plan stage, where we're going to define our floor plan size, what its aspect ratio is, what our target utilization is inside there. Next, we're going to take our hard macros. We're going to place them inside the design. We can place them in absolute coordinates, or we can use relative placements. We're going to usually define halos and blockages around the macros so we don't bother their pin access. Next, we're going to define basic regions and blockages inside the chip if needed. So we can define placement regions, as we mentioned before, and if we need placement blockages, if necessary, we'd also define routing blockages. Next, we're going to define global nets. So this is a point that we have our design. We decided that our power is called VDD. Let's say this pad over here, we call the net that connects to a VDD. And so we'll have this VDD running all over the chip. But then we have an inverter. And when we look inside the left of the left or the lib of the inverter, what we see is that inside it has a nice inverter here, but it calls this VCC. And this it calls, let's say, VSS, but we called our pin here, we called it ground. So how do we get VDD to connect to VCC? Well, that's what we do with what we call global nets. We say there's a global net called VDD, and all the inverters should connect the VDD to their pin that's called VCC. Remember, when we have multiple power domains, we're going to have something like VDD1 and VDD2, right? And so therefore, we're going to say an inverter in here should, there its VCC should connect to VDD2, while this should connect to VDD1. Anyway, that can also get kind of complex, and that's in our UPF, CPF, we can define those things. Okay, next we're going to create power rings. So often we're going to make a ring around the design that is a thick ring that will have VDD and ground that's easy to connect to from the external pad. So if we have a ring around here, it's easy to connect these guys to the ring, and it's easy to connect stripes and so forth to the ring. So it often makes our design much easier if we do that. Okay, next we're going to build a power grid. So we're going to throw down our stripes of VDD and ground across the design, make the different via stacks between them, and so forth. Okay, next we're going to assign pins to the design. So that means that we have to decide where our peripherals will sit if we have our VDD, if we're at the full chip level. Of course, that's going to be defined by the IO placement. So that's it for our discussion of floor plan. It was a bit higher level type of a lecture, but it's really something you have to do. You have to gain experience from, you have to do a lot of trial and error, see how our routing congestion becomes, see how our placement comes out, what kind of timing we can get. And this is something you'll have to go through many times. Floor planning usually takes up a large part of the design time of a backend designer.